Hi folks, this is David Kwan here, and this video I kind of just want to read from something I wrote in my blog a couple of days ago. I do have a wordy blog where I don't talk, but I write stuff, and it's a WordPress blog site. You can go there. It's davidatimkwan.wordpress.com. The link is in the description below, but I wrote this a couple of days ago. It's about depression. As a social work student, in NYU, and NYU is very clinical. It's known to be a very clinical school, so a lot of our things that we learn about is about mental health, and a lot of focus on mental health and clinical practice. So I do have some kind of education on that and training. Maybe not as much as I wouldn't say I'm an expert in that, but this is kind of what I wrote about depression overall. This is just kind of what I wrote. It doesn't really. There are probably YouTube videos out there that have talked more passionately or more eloquently or more expertly about this topic, but I just want to share with you guys what I wrote about depression, and I titled it Depression, Where Does It Come From? And this is what I wrote. Depression, formerly referred to as melancholia. It was called melancholia like 100 years ago. That was kind of the clinical definition back then. And to me, it doesn't really make much sense when I think about it, you know. All living beings strive to survive and be happy. Yet, so how and why can it be that they'll get depressed, you know? Instead of being driven to keep on and find joy, depression is an invisible sort of affliction that makes people dread doing anything. It'll have you sleeping too much, it'll prevent you from falling asleep when you desperately want to, so it's the opposite sides that you experience both, or some people only experience insomnia, some people only experience not being able to wake up. There's a series of slow thumping in the heart, and as each second passes by, everything seems permissible, but nothing feels worth doing. Survival, you know, on the other hand, requires a person to grit one's teeth, you know, to clench one's fists and keep on keeping on. If the world is unfair, then there's this empowering sense of, well, I'm not going to let that stop me. There's this sort of rage against the world and a source of fuel that propels you forward towards your dreams and ambitions. Depression, on the other hand, is that rage turned inwards. If the world is unfair, then it's somehow your own fault that things haven't gotten better, that there doesn't seem to be anything you can do to knock away the sense that nothing will change, that nothing will get better. Life can be relatively comfortable for people who have depression, and there may not be that much things to feel sad about or that many events that make you feel sad, but even so, when people have depression, it's this melancholia that spreads from the ceaselessly pumping heart to all the outer parts of the veins, to the fingertips, to the tip of the toes. Maybe this dread comes from somewhere, you think. Maybe it's the past experiences that you felt sad that's kind of triggering this. You know, maybe it's all the things that tragic things that you read about in novels, all the sad things you've seen in movies. But you know, that can't be all of it though, because surely depression existed hundreds of years before the invention of movies, before people was really involved with novels and whatnot. You know, or did it? I don't know. Regardless, why is depression afflicting people so pervasively? Where does it come from? Not that, you know, I'm diagnosed with depression or anything, and I'm sure my words here do no justice to the real anguish and pain that this condition can trigger. But even so, I feel strongly that this is a very perplexing question. It's not like the source of the condition can be determined. Sometimes people do get to this state due to some kind of traumatic event and due to some kind of consistent exposure to life debilitating conditions like extreme poverty or cancer, or constantly being stressed out and overwhelmed, or following, you know, depression can follow the abuse or withdrawal of a substance like alcohol or coffee, or due to so many other factors that are just not known yet. But oftentimes, people get depression for no reason. What's odd though is that so many people are affected, yet ironically, they will feel like no one can understand them, that they're the only people who knows what it's like. And depression is this invisible, gnawing feeling inside, and it's compounded by endless streams of self-loathing thoughts, like I said, it's a rage turned inwards. People who don't have depression have a rage against the world, have this ambition against the world, to fight back against the world, to make themselves better. But people with depression, it's that rage turned towards yourself, into yourself. And that's why people with depression or people who might be feeling a little bit of that, try to shrug it off and say, it's not a problem. I don't have this problem. Maybe if no one notices that I have this, then it's not a problem at all. And they have to do that for a lot of them. They have lives to lead. They have family members to support, bosses to report to, workplaces to go to. It hurts, and it's hard to have depression, but there's a sense that no one must know. Maybe it'll go away eventually. Maybe all that's needed are some friends, something to keep busy, anything. But the stigma and label that can come with actually being honest about having this. And that kind of staying inside and not being so secretive, that triggers even more rage and anger inwards. And all sorts of judgmental questions start flooding into the ego dams. You know, there's questions that you're asking yourself, like, why are you being such a coward about this? What's wrong with you? Can't you stop being a whiner and just get off your butt and do something? These are the questions that, you know, a lot of people with depression will ask themselves, but it's also the questions that society asks them too. And when other people actually says those questions aloud to people with depression, all of a sudden, that's a shock to the system for the people. That's when it really hurts. The rage turned inwards is validated by society. And that's shocking. Even with the awareness that people are generally well-intentioned in these kind of remarks, the exposure to cruelty of the real world reinforces the lonely introversion. True emotions are to remain hidden, and whatever else, especially the positive statements, joyful expressions, are to be feigned on the outside. They're supposed to be faked. The world will never know how draining and exhausting all this kind of feigning is. Wherever depression comes from, it's a real condition that afflicts millions of people. Its severity is widely varying depending on the person. Some people will live with depression throughout their whole lives, akin to how diabetics live with their diabetic conditions the rest of their lives. Some people will have one extremely debilitating episode and will eventually come to recover fully from that depressive episode. Some people will live quite unaffected most of their lives, except for certain moments in their lives when they are suddenly gripped by the full force of depression and melancholia. For some people, depression is not even among the greatest of their daily challenges, as they might have to fend off manic states, haunting hallucinations, self-damaging addictions, physical illnesses, and all other kinds of mental and biological health conditions that make their life so unfair. So, where does depression come from? It's a good question to ask, at least initially, I suppose. But imagine if someone found out, you know, through a doctor's appointment that she has type 2 diabetes. How long would the doctor stay on the question of how this person came to have diabetes? Where did her diabetes come from? It's a good question to ask, initially. Soon afterwards, then with diabetes is the accepted notion that the person will need treatment and support. But of course, only if she's willing to accept help. With diabetes, educating and motivating the person to seek support and treatment is essential. But because there's less stigma surrounding this chronic condition than compared to depression, most people with diabetes would typically be open to accepting assistance. The big difference with depression is that people aren't even willing to confide that they have this issue. It's difficult to know who can be confided in. For working class people living paycheck to paycheck with basic health insurance or not no health insurance at all, you know, seeing a therapist doesn't really enter into their consciousness. And again, the thing about the worst forms of depression is the sense that nothing will help, that nothing will get better. So why bother even trying? It's enough that the rage is turned inwards. But when this rage is validated by those onlooking eyes of the outside world, then the pain is unbearably magnified. It's no wonder many people will turn to pharmaceuticals and substances as stopgap solutions. Living in a society that so values productivity and growth, people must at all costs find ways to keep their personal, internal problems from messing with their professional and social lives. Taking the time to breathe and really address this issue risks people labeling you as lazy, as cowardly, as unmotivated. Society will allow some breaks, but not for too long. and never ever unconditionally. So while the question, where does depression come from, is probably an impossible question to answer, you know, maybe the more pragmatic question is, how are we as a society making depression worse for people who have it? And then following that question, how should we support the people who are dealing with depression? So that's something I wrote about depression. I hope you guys enjoyed. I know it sounds really scripted. I mean, it is. I wrote it and I read it. But those are kind of my general thoughts about it. As a social work student, I mean, this is the kind of a topic that is big. And a lot of people, when they think about depression, they also think about suicidal ideation and suicide. But those two are not necessarily completely directly related. Some people can be depressed without having kind of a serious suicidal ideation. It's always kind of there, but it's not, you know, it's not necessarily the serious issue. The depression itself might be the thing. You know, people feel depressed, people feel sad, and it's this anguish, internal turmoil that happens inside, and that's the issue itself sometimes, and not necessarily, oh, is this person gonna kill himself or herself? You know, that's a serious issue too, and that's a more immediate issue that we tend to focus on. But depression itself is an issue too. Along with many people with mental illnesses, there's this thing called comorbidity, where people have multiple kind of mental health issues that's going on at the same time. Some people can be bipolar and have depressive episodes, and at the same time be suffering from trauma and have anxiety, and so have all kinds of mental health issues kind of happening at the same time. And that's called comorbidity of mental health conditions. But either way, what I think the thing that I want to point out is really the difference in the way we think about health conditions. If somebody is suffering from more medical, physical conditions like diabetes, which is a lifelong condition, as it can be, the same thing with depression, there's a whole different way people kind of treat the person with diabetes compared to a person with depression, for example. And I think that's an issue that we have as a society, and that's kind of the thing I wanted to kind of bring up as I wrote about this. And the final question, you know, how should we support the people who are dealing with depression? I didn't answer that in this blog. I'm not gonna address it in this video because this video is already so long. But that's something to kind of consider, and it's definitely something I'll try to address more in future videos on this channel and whatnot. I am a social work student, but it is really ironic that I haven't talked too much in this channel about kind of social work topics. So I figure now is probably a good time to start doing that more and more in this channel. Hope you guys enjoyed. Leave your comments and questions below, and feel free to email me. My email's in the video description, and my link to my blog is in the video description as well. Cheers.